The Orlando Magic had a formula last year, so why do things feel off? It starts with the bench today on Locked On Magic.
You are Locked On Magic, your daily Orlando Magic podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
And you are indeed Locked On Magic. Today is November 8th, 2024. My name is Philip Rossenreich. I'm the senior writer over at OrlandoMagicDaily.com. Of course, follow me on Twitter at @PhilipRR_OMD. On today's episode of Locked On Magic, why do the things feel off about the Orlando Magic? Let's start with one area the Magic are not performing as well as they did last year. The bench. We'll break down how things have changed for the Magic's bench coming up here in just a moment. First, we want to thank you again for making Locked On Magic part of your day every day. And now you can make it even more part of your day because your favorite podcast now has a newsletter. Introducing the Locked On Magic Daily Newsletter, the one stop for ultimate team and league coverage delivered right to your inbox. Sign up for free now at LockedOnDaily.com. That's LockedOnDaily.com and start your day with the all new free Locked On Magic newsletter. Today's episode of Locked On Magic is brought to you by Prize Picks. Download the app today and use code LOCKEDONNBA to win $50 instantly when you play your first $5 lineup. Prize Picks, run your game. We talked about this yesterday, that the Magic have a way to win. And we talked about it more specifically yesterday in the wake of the Magic's loss to the Indiana Pacers, that the Magic started to kind of find something that they can hold on to, something that maybe they can repeat, something that tells us what's necessary for this team to win. Ultimately, that's like what we're thinking about and what we're trying to figure out is, okay, in this new reality, what's it going to take to win? Now, late last week, about a week ago now, maybe it was early this week, I don't remember. All these episodes run together at a certain point. I noted that there are some things going on with this team that aren't Paolo Banchero related. There are things that are very much, okay, the Magic don't have their best player. Players are having to fill in and do more, and maybe they're not quite up to snuff. And that's good to know. That's important to learn. But there are some things going on with this team that are independent of Paolo's absence. I think I talked a little bit about this, and I want to expand on this. One of the big things that this Magic team is missing is their bench. Last year, the bench was the big factor, a huge factor in the Orlando Magic becoming the 5 seed in the Eastern Conference and reaching 47 wins. The Magic's bench was an extreme strength. It was a big piece of the puzzle for this team in general, or as a whole. The Magic could rely on their bench to erase deficits, take leads, expand leads, and blow games open. That group of, at various points of the season, but mostly Markelle Fultz, Franz Wagner, Cole Anthony, Jonathan Isaac, Mo Wagner, or Joe Ingles, Anthony Black at times, that group was a superpower for this team. When the Magic said they had depth, they could put their money where their mouth was. They really had depth. Well, yes, the playoffs revealed some of the weaknesses of those lineups, and that's why you know depth is important until you get to the playoffs. The Magic really leaned on their bench to be successful in the regular season. The numbers are pretty plain and simple. The Magic last year finished fourth in the league in bench scoring with 41.5 points per game off the bench. Among the Magic's most used lineups, the bench group with Franz Wagner had a +4 net rating, and the bench group without Franz Wagner had a +4 net rating. That group with Wagner had a +21.1 net rating in 81 minutes. Again, there's a lot of mixing and matching. That line maybe wasn't as on the floor as much as we think it was, but the Magic's bench was pretty darn good last year. No getting around it. Mo Wagner had a career year on both ends of the floor. The reintroduction of Jonathan Isaac for a longer period of time had huge effects on the defense. Joe Ingles and Markel Fultz were both very solid playmakers who understood their roles. Cole Anthony led the team in scoring off the bench, understood how to get into gaps and what his job was for that team. Never forget what Cole Anthony did in game six of the playoffs last year. That offensive rebound was so huge. And yes, Franz Wagner, the team's plus minus king, the team's analytics king, succeeded because he was part of this dynamic bench group. Well, Markel Fultz is gone. Joe Ingles is gone. Cole Anthony is coming off. It's not even in the rotation right now. And the Magic's bench is not the same. So far this year, 9 games, small sample size. So far this year, the Magic's bench has been mediocre, if not an outright negative. They're averaging just 34.2 points per game off the bench. That's 16th in the league. And for a team with such a small margin for error on offense, losing that many points, the Magic are already down 29 points per game with Paolo out. Now losing 7 points per game, 7.5 points per game almost. That is a huge deficit that a team that is struggling to score is struggling to make up. And again, just look at the numbers. The Magic's bench is not performing the way they expected or the way that they'd hoped after last season. Cole Anthony led the team in scoring last year with 11.6 points per game. He's no longer in the rotation, just having an abysmal shooting season. Mo Wagner averaged 10.9 points per game on 60.1% shooting and 33% from three. He was 67.3% on two-point field goals last year. This year, that scoring average is up, 11.3 points per game, but the efficiency is down. 50% shooting overall, 23.8% on threes, 62.2% on twos. And when Mo Wagner's not scoring, his defensive shortcomings become a whole lot more noticeable. And frankly, it feels like Jonathan Isaac's not there to clean up the mess. Jonathan Isaac is averaging only 5.3 points per game, but shooting only 39.3% from the floor. He was at 51% last year for 6.8 points per game. He averaged 1.9 stocks per game last year, that steals and blocks. This year, he's averaging only 1.6. So a little bit of a decrease there. It's not nothing too noticeable. More than that, Isaac has always been a tricky player because offensively, maybe he doesn't add everything that he should. His defense has always been great. And last year, the Magic had a 102 defensive rating with Isaac on the floor, the best among all rotation players, but more importantly, a plus 10.9 net rating. That means they did pretty well offensively. This year, the Magic have a 105.9 defensive rating with Isaac on the floor, which is still pretty darn good. It's actually fourth among all rotation players on the Magic, but they're only scoring 75.8 points per 100 possessions when he is on the floor. Now, that's not all on Isaac. I want to make that perfectly clear. That is not all on Isaac. But it tells you that not even Jonathan Isaac's great defense can cover up a bad offense. And that bench group that Isaac is largely playing with is not performing. And that's not diving into Jet Howard looking like a rookie. Let me pull up his stats real fast, give you the word on him. Jet Howard is struggling this year with the opportunity that he's been given, shooting just 32.3% from three. And again, a lot of it coming in garbage time. A lot of it coming at the end of games. He's a young player. You got to give him some time. But look, he's not performing. Tristan Da Silva's down the starting lineup. Anthony Black has been very up and down, played a lot better on Wednesday, but really struggled through the first four games of this road trip. Really not performing at the level that he did after that breakthrough against the Pacers at home last Monday. This is all to say again that it's early in the season. Nothing is settled. Nothing is certain. Nothing is taken in granted quite yet. But this is a concerning trend. This is not what the Magic need. The Magic depend on their bench. I look no further than Wednesday's game against the Pacers. Why did Orlando's offense suddenly look so much better? Well, it's because Anthony Black got 12 points and 6 assists, aggressively attacking the basket and finishing at the rim. It's because Mo Wagner had 14 points. It's because Jonathan Isaac had 9 points and 6 rebounds. That's 35 points off the bench right there. Now, the Pacers got a lot of contributions off the bench too. They're the highest field goal percentage from bench players in NBA history. That's not necessarily the Magic's fault. They made some shots, but that shows you that, yes, even in that game where the Magic's bench played better, it didn't play well enough. And look, the Pacers have one of the best benches in the league. They have one of the highest scoring benches in the league. That's just what you're going to get. So here's the deal. We know the Magic need their strong bench. We know that the Magic will go as far as their bench will take them. But the bench has got to take them there. The bench has got to get there. And right now, this is a big element the Magic are missing. This is something the Magic have to be better at. They have to supplement their starters because A, the starters are down a pretty big piece in Paolo Banchero right now. And B, the Magic have to have a high-scoring bench to be successful. This is something that maybe the Magic expected to let down, and maybe that's the reason why to be a little pessimistic about this team, but this is something the Magic need to turn around. They need consistency from the bench to make this thing work. That was the key. That was a key to the formula, not the key, but that was a key to the formula last year. And right now, it's a part of the formula that's missing this year. A big part of the formula missing is Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. We'll talk a little bit about his struggles so far this season and why maybe you shouldn't be that worried. We'll get to that coming up here in just a moment. But first, today's episode of Locked On Magic is brought to you by our friends over at Prize Picks. Daily fantasy games are confusing. Like, plain and simple, go play some daily fantasy games. You're going to run into a salary cap that's confusing, a scoring system that's confusing, and a player pool system that is confusing. You want simple. Simple is always better, and Prize Picks could not be any easier or an any easier way to play daily fantasy sports. All you got to do is pick more than or less than on any stat and watch the winnings roll in if you guess them correctly, if you pick them correctly. And now you can win up to 100 times your money on Prize Picks with as little as 4 correct picks in your Prize Pick player pool. Prize Picks is the only real money daily fantasy platform too with an injury insurance policy so that your lineups stay in play even if one of your players gets injured. If your player leaves in the first half and does not return, Prize Picks will keep your lineup live. Prize Picks invented the flex play, which we could still cash out if your lineup isn't perfect. You can even double your money even if one of your picks doesn't hit. There are so many ways to win, and you can get your money back even with a solid performance with a few misses in tow. That's all we want. We want to have a little fun, want a little grace to make mistakes. There's a lot of these games don't give you that grace. So sign up today and get $50 instantly when you play $5. You don't even need to receive the $50 bonus. It's guaranteed. Download the app, use code LOCKEDONNBA to get $50 instantly after you play your first $5 lineup. Again, $50 instantly after you play your first $5 lineup using the code LOCKEDONNBA. Prize Picks, run your game. Today's episode of Locked On Magic is also brought to you by our friends over at FanDuel. Get ready to tackle the NFL action with FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook, because right now, new customers can bet $5 and get $150 in bonus bets if you win. The FanDuel Sportsbook app gives you everything you need to place live bets on the NFL all in one place. If you're getting ready for NFL action on Sunday, they have all the odds for you ready and available for the big Florida teams this weekend. Tampa Bay, 6.5-point home underdogs against San Francisco 49ers. Miami Dolphins, 1.5-point road dogs at the Los Angeles Rams. You can find this and so much more. The Jacksonville Jaguars, 7-point dogs at home, the Minnesota Vikings. If you're looking ahead to football this Saturday, I forgot what day it is. If you're looking ahead to football this Saturday, you could get Florida looking at 22.5-point road dogs at Texas, or UCF heading to Arizona, just 2.5-point dogs with Scatterboo's status uncertain for the Sun Devils. If you're looking ahead to Friday's game against the New Orleans Pelicans, the Magic are back as favorites at home, 4.5-point favorites against the Pelicans. See if the Magic can bounce back and end this losing streak. So when you get a hunch in the middle of the game, you can check out the latest stats, do live play-by-play, and so much more on the same page where you place your bets with FanDuel. Just visit FanDuel.com to join today, and you can start with $150 in bonus bets if you win your first $5 bet. That's FanDuel.com. Never waste a hunch. Make every moment more with FanDuel, an official sportsbook partner of the NFL. One of the, probably the biggest message that I get, and if you do send me this message or if you commented it, I see it, I hear you, I validate your frustrations. Everyone wants to know what's going on with Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. And look, I get it, big price tag. I get it, big free agent signing. He was supposed to make this offense function. It's not functioning. It's been pretty disappointing. I'm not going to pretend otherwise. I'm not panicking about it. I'll explain why here in a minute. But it's been disappointing because, yes, Kentavious Caldwell-Pope was supposed to deliver a lot to this team. He was supposed to take this team to the next level. And obviously, we're not there yet. Obviously, he hasn't. His stat line for the season is pretty much as bad as he's been since his rookie year. 6.8 points per game, 32.8% shooting, 24.4% from three, 41.4% effective field goal percentage. He's been great defensively. He's averaging 1.4 steals per game. Like, he's been active. And he's been great defensively. Don't get me wrong. But the Magic brought him in and paid him this much money because he is one of the best three-point shooters in the league. And I'm sorry if I come across a little snippy in these comments. People are like, why didn't the Magic go after more offense? Kentavious Caldwell-Pope isn't working out. It's like, dude, guys, Kentavious Caldwell-Pope is literally one of the best shooters in the league. He shot 40% or better from three in three of the last 4 years. He shot 39% in the 1 year that he didn't. The year before that started, he shot 38.5%. He's had one, like, really bad year shooting when he was at volume, and that was his third year in 2016 at 30.9%. To say the least, none of us are worried about Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. And look no further than Wednesday's game against the Pacers. Kentavious Caldwell-Pope had his first second double-digit game with the Magic, 13 points, 5 for 10 shooting, 2 for 5 from 3. That feels super modest, but considering how much he has struggled, it meant something. Add in 5 rebounds, his scoring, his ability to space the floor, his 3-point shooting was vital in that run to close the game in the second quarter. Obviously, the Magic still have to find a way to get him shots. He needs to be taking at least 5 threes a game, and really, they've done a good job at that. He's only shot fewer than 5 threes in 4 games this season, and 2 of those games he shot 4. So I think we're looking to get Kentavious Caldwell-Pope at like 5 to 7 threes per game, and especially now that Jalen Suggs has the ball in his hands a lot more and he's not getting the same spot-up opportunities, the Magic should be looking for ways to use KCP and use Kenny to get open shots or to just space the floor and be a threat to shoot. You're seeing the Magic start to use him a little bit as a screener in pick and rolls. You're starting to see him use him as a ghost screener in addition to running him to the corners, which he's very, very good at. But at the end of the day, he's just got to make threes. Like, he's got to make those shots. But it's important to remember that shooters go through some ups and downs. Even good shooters go through ups and downs. Last year, he shot 40.6% from three. I want to point to one stretch, 2-week stretch in January of last year. 2-week stretch where Kentavious Caldwell-Pope shot 25.6% from three. 25.6% over an 8-game stretch last January. He still shot 40% from three. Now, past performance is not an indicator of future success, but it's not going to take very much for Kenny to get himself going. Once he gets going, it's going to be fine. And very, very clearly, there is still time for him to get going. there is still time for him to make shots and get involved. And he did it last year. He had a bad stretch last year. He's had bad stretches throughout his career. He's a shooter. It happens. It stinks that it's happening right off the top, that this is our first impression of him, that he is missing open threes. KCP is too good of a shooter to keep missing. And hopefully Wednesday was a turning point. Hopefully Wednesday is showing us that Kentavious Caldwell-Pope is going to bounce back. That he is going to be the shooter that we all imagined he was and be someone that will make 3 of 6 every night or 3 of 5 every night or 2 of 5 every night. Granted, I will agree with this. The Magic still need to get KCP more shots. Kind of like with Gary Harris, and I know people yelled at me for this. Gary Harris receiving the ball was a sign of the team's healthy offense. It means the ball was moving. And look, Orlando is still leading the league in corner threes per game. They are getting the quality three-point looks that they need to get. Kentavious Caldwell-Pope is getting is getting at least some of those corner threes. The Magic need to find ways to keep him involved, whether it's bringing him off movement, cutting him to the basket, using him as a screener, which the Nuggets did with Nikola Jokic. We saw a little bit of that. He got one of his threes in that second or third quarter on a screen pick and roll with Franz Wagner, where Wagner was able to run his man into the screen. They didn't switch. Kenny popped open, got a three, and then I think the next play or the play before, they ran it. He slipped the screen, got a cut to the basket. They can be creative with how they use Kentavious Caldwell-Pope, and they need to be creative with how they use Kentavious Caldwell-Pope, even if teams are going to switch. And I think the Magic did a lot of that to try and get Tyrese Halliburton on Franz so they could attack Tyrese Halliburton. Kentavious Caldwell-Pope is a vital player to this team. And yes, just like the bench that I talked about in the previous segment, he has not performed. The Magic need more from him. The Magic need more from everybody. Without Paolo Banchero, and I think Casey Kenny benefited a lot from Paolo. Paolo was looking for him in that opposite corner. He could fire that pass to him in a way that I don't know if anyone else on the team can. That is a pass that they're looking for, to get Paolo going one way and firing it to the weak side corner for a quarter three. That is something the Magic look for. They look to, they haven't run any hammer screens on that, but I'd imagine hammer screens are coming to get open corner threes. But the Magic need Kenny to play. They need him to make shots. Like, that's how we have to evaluate him, is he has to make shots. I will continue to argue every element of Kentavious Caldwell-Pope's game has been as promised, except the three-point field goal percentage. And once that turns around, and very clearly it still can, very clearly he can still be a 40% three-point shooter. Once that happens, and I do believe it is when, not if, once that happens, then we're going to see this offense begin to look functioning and better overall. We know the biggest issue with this Magic offense is the three-point field goal percentage right now. And the Magic, as I mentioned throughout the week, are getting quality looks that just have to go down. They aren't going down quite yet. They will get there. Hopefully they will get there. Maybe I shouldn't assume they will get there, but hopefully they will get there. But Kenny is a big part of this equation, and very, very slowly he is starting to turn that corner. Friday starts a humongous homestand for the Magic, how the Magic can make the most of the homestand, starting with Friday's game against the Pelicans. We'll get to that coming up here in just a moment. But first, today's episode of Locked On Magic is brought to you by Skims. I mentioned this in our last read, but if you're thinking about your underwear, you're probably wearing the wrong underwear. Like, plain and simple. We don't like to talk about it. It's taboo to talk about. If you're thinking about it, you're doing it wrong. So what makes Skims different? It's underwear you don't have to think about. It hugs your body in a comfortable way. So you feel like you're not wearing any underwear. You probably should be wearing underwear. You definitely should be wearing pants. I know we're out of the pandemic, people. Wear pants. But Skims is underwear that makes you feel confident and comfortable. And that's all you can ask for. I have always been a boxers guy. And sometimes I've started to find boxers to be a little constricting, to be perfectly honest. So I started trying out some boxer briefs. I got a pair of Skims and found them to be incredibly comfortable. And frankly, I'm probably not going to be buying boxers for a while. When I need to replace underwear, I'm probably going to be buying boxer briefs. I'm probably going to be buying them from Skims. They have been that comfortable. They have so many different styles. They have so many different ways to wear them. You can find the right pair, the right set for you. Whether it's a boxer brief or a cotton brief, Skims has it all for you. So shop Skims Men's at skims.com. Let them know we sent you. After you place your order, select podcast in the survey and select our show in the drop-down menu that follows. And if you're looking for the perfect gifts for the whole family, Skims just launched their biggest holiday shop ever, also available at skims.com. Check it out today at skims.com. Again, let them know that we sent you by selecting podcast in the survey after you place your order and selecting our show in the drop-down menu that follows. Check it out today at skims.com. The Orlando Magic open a gargantuan five-game homestand. And look, it's too early in the season to call anything must-win. It's too early in the season to be really obsessed with who you're playing. Obviously, games are big. These games all count. Like, it's not like an April game is worth more than a November game. But let's be real. The Magic are on a five-game losing streak. The Magic lost a ton of games on the road. Couldn't put those pieces together. They're coming home to the Kia Center. They're 2-0 in the Kia Center. They're getting a chance to catch their breath. But none of that matters if they don't win. They got to make up for this five-game losing streak. They got to make up for the losses on the road. You had a five-game losing streak on the road? Okay. You've got to make it up at home. The whole idea, like the general thought is go 500 on the road or make up the difference with your home games. You expect to take care of your home floor. And so, okay, some of us were willing to give the Magic a pass for the road trip. Like, it was going to be a tough road trip regardless of the injury. Chicago's playing well, even though they're 3-6. Cleveland's obviously undefeated. Dallas is playing well. Indiana is a very good team. Oklahoma City is, you know, one loss. Coming against Denver on Wednesday. That was a tough road trip. It was always going to be a tough road trip. A 2-3 road trip would have been a success in a lot of ways. But that's only because we know the Magic can take care of their business at home. And winning at home now becomes essential. The Magic have to make that ground back up. Because after this homestand, the Magic go on a 3-game West Coast road trip. They have a couple games at home and then a big East Coast road trip featuring all the New York teams, 2 games against Brooklyn, who are playing very, very well, including an NBA Cup game, the game against the Knicks, and then 2 games against the Sixers. Magic can get 3 games against the Sixers here in the next 3 weeks, 2 more games against Brooklyn, just some really tough, you know, opponents that don't look so tough on paper right now, but are very, very tough. And you get a West Coast trip in the middle of that. This five-game homestand is about stability. And after playing teams that are at the top of the standings and at the top of their games, this is going to be a homestand that has, at least on paper, opportunities to win. It starts Friday against New Orleans Pelicans. The Pelicans are also 3-6, just 1-3 on the road. They are one of the worst defensive teams in the league so far this year. In fact, let me just pull up the stats here real fast, excuse me, for not being prepared. The New Orleans Pelicans are currently ranked 30th in the league in defensive rating, giving up 119.9 points per 100 possessions. And they're a team that does not really have a center. They're hurt, really, really hurt right now. Zion Williamson is back after missing a few games, but CJ McCollum's out. DeJounte Murray's out. Still got to deal with Brandon Ingram. Still got to deal with Zion Williamson, but they're a team that is giving up a lot of points and I believe giving up a lot of points in the paint. Yeah, New Orleans has given up 56.4 points in the paint, second most in the league. Indiana was 26th. Orlando just scored 70 points in the paint against Indiana. This is a game for the Magic to get their offense right. New Orleans is a bad defensive team. The Magic are getting good looks. They're back home where they should shoot better, where they should perform better. This is a game the Magic must win just to get off the schneid, get a win, feel that positivity again. But the homestand continues. with the Washington Wizards, who are 2-4. Then the Magic take on the Charlotte Hornets, 3-5, playing very, very well. Dangerous team with LaMelo Ball. Brandon Miller's very, very good. Not easy games, but opponents that feel beatable. Then the Indiana Pacers come back to town. The Magic have fared pretty well against them, even with the loss on Wednesday. Then they get their second NBA Cup game against the Philadelphia 76ers. And while Joel Embiid will be back for that game, the Sixers are still just 1-6. They will be without Tyrese Maxey in that game. So be lacking that point guard. I'm not here saying the Magic are going to go 5-0 on this homestand. It's possible. But this is the kind of homestand that we talk about toward the end of the season about banking up wins. You know, if we're going to think about this as a horse race, it is election week. If we're going to think about this as a horse race of needing to run up margins. This is where you run that score up. This is where you pick up those wins so that you have some grace to lose some road games, to have a bad road trip like the Magic had last week. Orlando needs to win on this homestand. They need to get back to 500. Right now, the Eastern Conference, the Indiana Pacers at 4-4 are third in the Eastern Conference. That's not going to stay the same. Someone's going to get that little win streak to get above 500 and establish themselves in that pecking order. But right now, the East is a complete mess. Like I mentioned earlier in the week, the East is giving the Magic grace to make mistakes. But it's also giving them an opportunity to zoom ahead. You go 5-0 on this homestand, you're 8-6. You go 4-1, you're 7-7. You're right there, back at 500, back in the middle of the Eastern Conference pack. And look, that West Coast road trip at Phoenix, at Clippers, at Lakers, not super daunting. Phoenix is playing really well at 7-1. The Clippers are 4-4. The Lakers are 4-4. You're not traveling for that second road trip, even though LA nightlife is undefeated. It's a man. As far as West Coast road trips go, it is manageable. This is to say, before the Magic schedule gets really, really tough in December with that stretch I talked about heading to New York, where Brooklyn looks a lot better all of a sudden, before the Magic get to a very road-heavy December, this is where they have to bank up some wins. It's not must-win time yet, but the Magic have to get to the front of the pack. They got to put themselves in a position to where they're in control of their destiny and just need a nice two-week push to race ahead of everybody and establish themselves. The Magic cut themselves at the knees a little bit. Didn't get out to the fast start that they needed to get out to. And again, the Paolo Banchero injury is a big factor in that. The Magic, you know, probably if they went 2-3 on this road trip instead of 0-5, they'd be 5-4. We could take 5-4. 5-4 is in good position. And then you come home, have another good homestand, you're eight and six. You can live with that. The Magic got to get back to that level. They got to get back to that level of maybe slightly ahead of 500. And again, this is all about survival until Paolo gets back. Be around 500, be in the Eastern Conference playoff race. And then when Paolo comes back, you make your push when he comes back. That's the race the Magic are running now. That's the tire strategy right now for the Magic. Hold steady, hold position, be in contention, be in the pack, and then be ready to zoom ahead when Paolo gets back. Again, that'll be around Christmas or New Year's Day. The Magic got to start with banking wins. And frankly, it starts with Friday. It's not a must-win game. It's too early for must-win games. But they must beat the Pelicans. They have to win this game. Sorry to my friends at Locked On Pelicans. They have to win this game. They need this game badly. They need confidence. They need that boost. They need it from the home crowd, from the home city. They absolutely need it. And this is their chance to begin to establish themselves as that number three team in the East. It's not far-fetched for them to be the number three team in the East with the way these standings have popped open in the first 10 games. The Magic are one of the disappointments in the first 10 games as it is, but there's still opportunity for them to get ahead. It starts with this five-game homestand over the next week, 2 weeks. But we'll see what happens. We'll talk about it on our next episode of Locked On Magic, but that's going to do it for me today. I want to thank you all again for listening to today's episode of Locked On Magic. You can, of course, find me on Twitter at @PhilipRR_OMD. Subscribe to the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, TuneIn, Himalaya, Google Play, Spotify, Odyssey, and all of the OMD podcasts to your podcast-enabled listening device. For the latest on the Orlando Magic, be sure to check out OrlandoMagicDaily.com. Of course, find us there on Twitter at @OMagicDaily. And for even more Orlando Magic content, be sure to check out my Patreon page, your Orlando Magic Hub, at patreon.com/OrlandoMagicHub. As always, thank you for your support. Now that you're done listening to me, your favorite podcast is now a newsletter. Introducing the Locked On Magic daily newsletter, the one-stop for ultimate team and league coverage delivered right to your inbox. Sign up for free now at LockedOnDaily.com. That's LockedOnDaily.com and start your day with the all-new free Locked On Magic newsletter. That's good news for me today, though. I want to thank you all again for listening to today's episode of Locked On Magic for Orlando Magic Daily and Locked On Magic. This has been Philip Ross. We'll see you all again next time for another episode of Locked On Magic.